Hello and welcome to Drive with the DW Car Show. Coming up, a monster of a pickup, the Toyota Hilux. A cute but slick city runabout, the Renault Twingo. Plus, the all-new Mazda CX-5. Jimba Itai is a Japanese phrase meaning the unity of horse and rider, and Mazda is using the slogan to promote the new CX-5. The developers aim to ensure it responds to the driver rather than vice versa. Ronnie Levstek wants to see whether he can become one with this speedy steed. Mazda has been riding high in Europe recently. The car maker has seen sales on the continent increase by 60% since 2012, and the CX-5 compact SUV has accounted for a major part of that growth. Its lightweight construction, efficiency, and an attractive look are among the principal factors for its success. Looking to build on those strengths, Mazda has enhanced the model after just 5 years. As with all modern cars, says Ronnie, the CX-5 boasts a plethora of sensors to monitor events and conditions on the road, and to a degree, forecast them too. It comes with predictive all-wheel drive, should you even need all-wheel drive. We tested the top-of-the-line sports edition of the CX-5, which in Germany sells for just under 35,000 euros. The engines are familiar. There's a choice of one 2.2-liter diesel and two naturally aspirated gasoline engines with capacities of 2 and 2.5 liters. Transmission is either stick or automatic, both with 6 speeds. The visual upgrade isn't immediately obvious, as the styling between the old and new versions barely differs. Apart from the 2 centimeters lost in height, the Mazda CX-5's dimensions have changed only in terms of millimeters. The length and width are practically identical. A closer look reveals that the A-pillars have been shifted back by 4.3 centimeters, which increases the distance to the front axle and stretches the car's proportions. The rear doors open up to 90 degrees to make access easier for both human and non-human cargo, although it doesn't make much sense in tight parking spaces. But once you're sitting inside, the Jimba Itai principle applies again. Rear passengers now have the option of connecting with the CX-5. Literally, as hidden underneath the armrest are 2 USB ports, one for each occupant. You can also activate the seat heating for the rear seats, which was previously not possible in the CX-5. Mazda has completely redesigned the front cabin. The driver operates the sat-nav and radio as usual via a knob on the center console. The dark finishes contrast with the white leather upholstery of the sports equipment line. According to Feng Shui, rearranging furniture increases the qi flow and therefore your well-being. Ronnie has never believed in that stuff, but there is something to Jimba Itai, and it works in the CX-5. You know what the car wants to do, and the car can predict what you want to do. The CX-5 has become a real all-rounder that can be recommended for every target group. Car tester Ines Petri says she's trying out the third generation Renault Twingo. Its engine is no longer here, but here instead. Ines says it now comes with a 6-speed dual-clutch transmission, which is unusual for runabouts like this, so she'll give it a try. Renault is only offering fuel-efficient 3-cylinder engines with a capacity of just 1 or 0.9 liters for this car. The power is sent to the rear wheels. Ines is testing the SCE 70 EDC, with 51 kilowatts of power. It trudges from 0 to 100 kilometers an hour in 14.5 seconds, reaching a top speed of 155. Ina says that even with the smallest engine, accelerating is good fun. She says the dual clutch transmission lets it accelerate smoothly and fast. This Twingo is 3 meters 59 long. That's 10 centimeters shorter than its predecessor. Its wheels are closer to the vehicle's corners, which extended the wheelbase by 13 centimeters. It's only available as a 5-door model. The rear handles are hidden away in the design. And of course, the rear-mounted engine has been insulated and covered. When you fold down the back seats, you get a flat cargo surface. Ines explained that this Twingo with dual-clutch transmission comes only with the intense high-end equipment line. She really likes the materials and finds that the buttons are kept to a minimum. That underscores her feeling that this Twingo is very easy to drive and simple to operate. The cruise control, for example, is located beside the gear shift and regulated with buttons on the steering wheel. The Twingo also has an eco mode. It shifts gears swiftly to help save fuel. That also keeps the noise down because the engine gets loud in the high rev range. And this little box can be placed in the cup holders, useful for stowing things. The turning circle of 8.6 meters makes the Twingo pretty agile. So while other cars take lots of cranking to make sharp turns, this compact can do it in a flash. But how does the tiny Twingo fare on the highway? Ines doesn't expect the Twingo to excel, but once you've gotten it up to speed and found your spot, it's all right. But Ines wouldn't recommend any tricky passing maneuvers. The 1-liter three-cylinder engine doesn't offer much extra thrust at high speeds. Speaking of which, it's time for another test. Ines calls down the guys. She needs their help. The Twingo is great for one person to get around town. But what if you want to take along a few passengers? Just getting in is already a problem. You've got to duck, and your knees will be up against the front seats. Ines wants to know how they're doing in the back. She realizes it's pretty cramped. She asks them to stick it out. Now the car's full, she wants to test the engine. Ines says she's going to give it a try. Ines says that when the Twingo's fully occupied and you're accelerating, you can really tell. You hit the gas and it shifts gear, but takes a while to pick up speed. Ines says it's certainly possible to ride around with some buddies, but you won't be quite as fast. Ines's verdict, she thinks the Renault Twingo is a feisty city car, but on long rides, it'll be cramped for four adults. She thinks the Twingo makes for a good family car. The dual-clutch transmission version can also be had with an engine 15 kilowatts more powerful. Ines would go for that one.
Für den würde ich mich entscheiden.
The Sports Turismo sees Porsche launching its first station wagon, and it's some debut. It makes the dash to 100 kilometers per hour in 4.6 seconds. Top speed is 275 kilometers per hour. The trunk has a capacity of 425 liters with the seats up and 1,295 liters when folded down. Mercedes has given the S-Class a new facelift. The front of the flagship model has been lightly reworked, while the radiator grille and bumpers are new. The taillights likewise have a new design, featuring a new crystal treatment. The lower section of the rear bumper has been slightly modified. Prices in Germany start at around 85,000 euros. Be afraid. Be very afraid. The Black Badge models are the dark side of Rolls-Royce. Dark, direct, and powerful. Spawned by the maker's own tuning attempts to balance individual luxury and outright bombast. Carter Reinhold asks, what more could a modern man or woman want than health, wealth, and coolness? So the sensible super rich don't buy just any Rolls-Royce, they plump for the Black Badge, the bad boy among British luxury cars. Even the Emily statuette is black. There's a black grille and lots of carbon and black tailpipe finishers. Rolls-Royces are known for being palaces on wheels, but the Black Badge version seems more like a rugged fortress in the Scottish Highlands. But Rolls wasn't content just to paint everything black. They've also been at work on the engine and transmission. After all, that's what tuning is all about. Aside from the smart carbon fiber composite rims, the profile hasn't changed. On request, the chrome window frames can be blackened too. At a total length of 5 meters 28, this mobile castle weighs in at a hefty 2,440 kilograms. Trunk capacity is 470 liters. Carbon fiber replaces wood trim, aluminum oust chrome, and matte black dominates the interior. Inside, the instrument panel is striking, sealed with six layers of clear varnish, hand-polished to a fine gloss, after being left to dry for a full 72 hours. As soon as he starts off, Reinhold senses that the steering is more direct and the dampers are firmer. At 465 kilowatts, the Reith Black Badge is the most potent Rolls to date, with its power further enhanced by its 870 newton meters of torque. Fuel consumption is rated at 14.6 liters per 100 kilometers. It accelerates from 0 to 100 kilometers per hour in 4.5 seconds. Reinhold discovers the jerks typical of fast starts and stops are absent. The low setting directs the automatic transmission to start shifting only after the engine reaches 6,000 revs, and the gas pedal responds more spontaneously. So the 2.5 tons are pretty nimble, but always a Rolls-Royce. Just as a weightlifter is not the ideal gymnast, a Rolls limo can hardly double as a sports car. The standards of self-assured elegance combined with uncompromising luxury are defining for the brand. So the suspension can only get so stiff and the exhaust only so loud. But there's a good reason to dress the Reith in black. With an average age of 46, today's Rolls buyers aren't the youngest, and they tend to want a chauffeur. The best way to appeal to a younger target group is with a sportier model that reflects their lifestyle. Rolls-Royce's darker side has its powers of attraction. The Black Badge marks its owner as a cutting-edge, style-conscious, and individualistic person. But anyone who spends over 300,000 euros on a car has never been normal. Maybe exceptional is the best description. A robust look and chunky proportions. The unmistakable Toyota Hilux. Typical Dodge Ram buyers would be all over this pickup, were it not for the engine. But more on that later. The Hilux offers an extremely high seating position and impressive ground clearance. The all-wheel version even boasts off-road credentials. Our car tester Emmanuel says the Toyota Hilux has a long tradition. It's been in production since 1968 and is now in its eighth generation. Over 18 million units were sold since it was first introduced. But unlike the Dodge Ram, the Hilux isn't available with a roaring V8 to suit its look. Our test car has a 2.4-liter diesel engine with 110 kilowatts of power. It goes from 0 to 100 kilometers per hour in 13 seconds and has a top speed of 170. The Hilux has a wheelbase of over 3 meters. That's half a meter longer than the total length of a smart car. Plus, its 1.8 meter height makes it one of the tallest contenders around. Plastic fender liners are optional for protecting the bodywork from scratches. The rear chrome bars are only available with the Invincible package. A trailer hitch is optional. It can pull a load of 3.2 tons. Emmanuel loves the bed. It's got room for 1,100 kilos of cargo. Anything will fit. But it could get wet in the rain, unless you invest 2,100 euros for a hardtop. So you might want to use a tarp. He says you could even take a nap in the back, weather permitting. The Hilux is 5.3 meters long in all three available body versions. The single cab has a single row of seats, while the extra cab has an extra seating row, but with little space. The double cab, like our test car, comes with plenty of space in the back. The Hilux's interior is stripped down, but you won't have to do without sat nav. Well, the Hilux is a utility vehicle, says Emmanuel. You don't get that feeling from the interior, because Toyota has made these synthetic materials here and here look like leather. The surface even has mock stitching. It's not actual leather. It's a single piece of plastic. It's cheap to produce and resistant to scratches and the like. A 7-inch touchscreen is standard fitted in the second equipment line, duty comfort, and upwards. The Hilux is much more than a utility vehicle. It also performs well on normal roads. An entry-level Hilux single cab can be had for 25,000 euros in Germany. Emmanuel says pickups are growing in popularity in Germany and elsewhere, and the Toyota Hilux has a long tradition to look back on, which is an advantage. It means Toyota can sell a tried and tested product in large numbers. A double cab edition of the Toyota Hilux will set you back 39,500 euros. Once every 4 years, the quiet German town of Hessisch Oldendorf becomes the temporary heart of the Volkswagen world. In June, over 45,000 VW fans again descended on the place for the 2017 edition of the International Vintage Volkswagen Show, hosted by its initiators Christian Gundmann and his father, Traugott. As Traugott explains, it all started in 1994 with a crazy idea of his son and his friend Bjorn. They invited Volkswagen to Hessisch Oldendorf. Traugott suggested they get better organized and eventually got involved himself. It was such a hit that many people said they'd like to come again. So they held the next show 2 years later. The first show had 68 cars, the second 280, and now it's got over 900. For a few days, Hessisch-Oldendorf's picturesque old town is clogged with classic pre-1968 VWs, with streets devoted to specific models from the Beetle to the VW Transporter and Carmen Ghia. Traugott is proud to report that they have cars from 28 nations and visitors from 49 countries. This year was a record, with four cars setting out for Hessisch-Oldendorf from Malaysia 3 months beforehand. That shows just how big the VW family is. At the world's largest vintage VW meet, the people's car lives up to its name, bringing fans together from all over the world. A Scottish bagpipes player welcomes the Malaysian marathon drivers.
It's about 22,000 plus kilometers. It took us 3 months and 10 days to be here. It was simply a wonderful journey. If anyone who drives an airpool and say they didn't have a breakdown, yes, there is. There'll always be.
Yeah, we did fix it along the way. We still reach all the destination on time.
We never miss a schedule yet.
For the Malaysian adventurers, a sense of honor requires them to drive their VW all the way back too, and no doubt make lots of more friends along the way.
It's a big family of Volkswagen. When I travel with them, I actually experience how they come and bring people together.
The car maker itself has set up a special exhibition to provide an in-depth look at the company's long history. Parked next to the world's oldest surviving Beetle are unique reproductions of long-lost prototypes. Andreas Hornig, technical director of VW's classic car collection back at headquarters in Wolfsburg, gives us the lowdown. These are four magnificent vehicles for the enthusiasts here that represent the birth of the Beetle, starting with the 1936 V3, a prototype, followed a year later by the V30 with lots of modifications. Also on show, the world's oldest Beetle, the 3803. It was the third car to be built in 1938 and the first to go into post-war production. It was known as the CCG Beetle. The VW Beetle, conceived and designed in the 1930s. Over 21.5 million had come off the production line by the time it was phased out in 2003. It is, without a doubt, the preeminent car of the 20th century. Traugott doesn't know anyone who doesn't have some relative who's driven a Volkswagen. He says Volkswagen is a link between people. There are no complexes. Everyone helps everyone else. Andreas Hornig tells how the entire town gears up for the show every 4 years. The shop windows are all decorated with Volkswagen paraphernalia, while the streets are car-themed. And, as everybody knows, a Volkswagen runs forever. And on a rally through local hills, the vintage VWs encounter a rare amphibious relative. VW's Type 166 has no need of a ferry to cross the river.
I cannot believe that it's a kleiner boat.
A kleiner Teilkäfer.
This driver explains it's part Beetle, part Porsche. It does up to 73 kilometers per hour. It was built from 1941 to 1943 and is awesome to drive. On the water, the Schwimmwagen does an impressive 10 kilometers per hour. Not many of the 14,000 built have survived. It's something completely new for the Malaysian VW fans.
I've never seen it in action before. So
I've never
the first
seen
time,
it before. It's cool, damn cool.
Campgrounds have been laid out for the fans all around Hessisch-Oldendorf. And the multinational atmosphere is very relaxed. The International Vintage Show is like a Woodstock of VW devotees. This couple from Germany might not understand what everyone's saying, but they understand what they mean.
Volkswagen.
What I really like about Volkswagen is the community.
You can go around, talk about Volkswagen.
On se retrouve.
And this visitor from Belgium finds friends of every nationality.
Nos amis bretons.
Yeah, it's a long trip, but I think it's worth it. It's a really nice place to be, and it's a good atmosphere, and everybody's happy. I think it's perfect the way it is. It's a Volkswagen festival, and it's worldwide.
Olaf Schmidt confirms that what they've seen so far tops everything. The organization is wonderful. Thanks to the 30 volunteers who've made the event another resounding success. Next time on Drive It, Audi bumps up the performance with the new RS5. And the BMW 530e.